Welcome to the Church Universal series, where we seek to tell the often untold story of the many apostolates in the Catholic Church, which are making a positive difference in the world through their charitable works and prayerful lives. What resources are available for physicians and healthcare professionals to find healing in their own lives and to be instruments of the Lord's healing to others? That is our topic today. Hello, I'm Father Joseph Mary, and today I'm speaking once again with members of the Catholic Medical Association. My guests today are Dr. Marie Busico, who is the president, and Mario Dickerson, who is the executive director. Welcome again to both of you.
Thank you, Father.
Now, Mario, give us a little bit of an overview about the Catholic Medical Association for those who missed the first program.
Absolutely. So we're a physician-led association of physicians and Catholic healthcare professionals, and we uphold the principles of the faith in science and medicine. And we have 2,300 members nationwide, over 100 guilds. And again, we use the word guild instead of chapters because we really want to focus on the spiritual development of our members and inspire them to imitate Jesus Christ.
Now, I see that you've taken a phrase of Pope Francis, field hospital, and you say that the Catholic Medical Association is a field hospital. How is that so?
Right. I love that imagery, obviously, from the medical perspective of what we do. But more importantly, because there's a culture war going on, and there's a lot of victims to this culture war, and not all of them are going to churches for healing. And oftentimes, they'll come into the doctor's office for that healing, because that spiritual woundedness evidences itself physically oftentimes. And so that first encounter of healing will be through the physician. And so really, you know, the CMA is there forming the physicians and how to help the whole person heal. And then in another way too, the physicians also need healing too, because they're victims in this culture war as well. And they're being attacked from all different sides. So providing through the CMA a support network of other like-minded physicians and giving that faith formation is an important part of what we do.
Talk about that, Doctor.
So yes, so physicians are in the trenches, obviously, but some of our physicians are also wounded. Some of our physician members used to prescribe all contraceptives. They used to perform abortions. And they've had their own conversion experience through their association with the Catholic Medical Association. So they behave, in my mind, as new converts to the faith. They're full of energy, and they're educating their patients and their colleagues on the errors of these practices.
You know, and I think especially those who've experienced the darkness of the dark choices of evil, they can especially be powerful witnesses.
Absolutely.
That doesn't work.
Exactly.
I've seen that side.
Exactly.
I've seen the fallout.
Know where
it's
going.
Exactly.
And so I would guess that they're even more zealous.
Yes, absolutely.
That's what you're finding.
Zeal is correct, yes.
Now, what are the ways that they are finding healing besides that conversion? But like, are your annual meetings, do they have opportunities for confession, those sorts of things?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, this is part of our annual meeting. It's like a retreat when you participate in this event. Not only do they have access to prayer, the mass, and confessions, but we also have speakers who are sharing their stories with us. They're educating us on the errors of these practices. And what can ultimately happen with these practices.
And the annual conference we had recently had over 700 attendees, mostly physicians. But I also encourage people to look into their local guild nearby because, you know, the annual conference is once a year, but to get connected on a local level with a guild, you know, they're having regular meetings, days of reflections, and there's that peer-to-peer relationship building.
And there's always a chaplain assigned to each guild?
Yes, to each guild, that's correct.
It's a requirement for starting a guild that they have a priest chaplain for it. And they provide the spiritual formation and guidance to the members.
There are spiritual fathers.
You know, I think that's so important, as we talked about the last time, that it's a demanding profession, and not only just the demands of the profession, but just the culture, and you're swimming against the tide, and probably a lot of your colleagues too.
Absolutely.
Their ideas, you know, their ideologies and so on, you're really swimming against the tide, and many times you need that support.
Sure, absolutely. We're preaching a countercultural message. Mm-hmm. Yes, absolutely.
I think that's one of the keys on so many of these groups at the Church Universal, is that they found mutual support and how necessary that is. No man is an island. Mm-hmm. You know, we have the Lord, of course, as the source of our strength, but He's called us to a communion of saints in heaven.
Yes.
That is to begin here on earth.
That's correct.
And so those who are striving to live faithful to the Catholic faith, doctors and healthcare professionals, they need that support too.
Absolutely.
Have you found that they've appreciated that, being part of this?
Absolutely. They're always looking, not only just being a part of it, but how can they get involved? They want to do more. And mm-hmm. I think that's one of our greatest challenges, is that there's so many opportunities to get involved and fight what needs to be fought, but build awareness on things that need to be communicated. So there's a lot of opportunities for our physician members.
Sure.
Yeah.
Now, we had talked before, and I think it came up as well, that when a person comes in, they're not a machine to be fixed, but there's a person, and we have to look at the whole person. So when you first see a patient coming in, often the wounds that our culture inflicts on them, that's an element in their recovery. Is that right?
Absolutely, and that includes things like my female patients who have had abortions.
Mm-hmm.
They're terribly wounded.
Yeah.
They're often suffering from depression or anxiety, insomnia, chronic abdominal pain that we cannot find the source of, and they don't want to talk about the abortion.
Right.
I mean, it's that traumatizing. So they're very wounded. Mm. Absolutely.
Right. And so you first have to address that. What's going on there?
Correct.
In order to know better
how
to help them in their recovery.
Right.
How else are you helping patients, those who are not physicians? How is the Catholic Medical Association beneficial to those outside of those who may gather, be there for the gatherings?
There's a number of things that we're doing to help patients. we run 8 radio ads on Catholic radio stations, but also secular radio stations, just to build awareness of the side effects of whether it's abortion, obviously assisted suicide or depression, that there's the side effects and how you can get treated for it. And so we, you know, patients have a right to know this information, which is often not communicated. So we also encourage patients to look at our website. There's a physician search tool in the upper right-hand corner that if they want to find a Catholic doctor nearby, you can search by specialties there as well. So there's and all the resources that we have available on the website, there's scientific research, there's a medical journal as well. So,
and I would also say that on a professional level, just by bearing witness to what you believe, that impresses my colleagues who are not Catholic physicians.
Right.
They understand I take 10 minutes during lunch to pray my Divine Mercy chaplet.
Mm-hmm.
And they may not understand that, but they respect that I'm taking time out of the day to pray.
Mm-hmm.
So just by bearing witness to what we believe, that makes an impression on them as well.
I was going to say, a little less tangible, but what we're also doing on a national and state level is trying to ensure that there is Catholic health care available to people.
Mm-hmm.
So if you don't want Catholic health care, that's fine.
Fine.
That's available to you, but there's a large demographic population that really wants authentic Catholic health care. And we're working with legislators and hospital administrators to make sure that patients who want that access to authentically Catholic health care can find it.
Sure.
So you're actually working there on Capitol Hill, and you're trying to ensure that we have access to good Catholic health care.
And what's important there too as well is to promote conscience protections, because that's essential.
Right.
Because without it, we cannot practice.
Mm-hmm.
We cannot practice medicine based on the dictates of our moral convictions.
Let's talk about those who are interested perhaps in joining the group. Do they have to be perfect doctors, perfect Catholics to be part of this organization?
Well, if I'm a member, the answer is obviously no. You know, none of us are perfect.
Right.
But this organization really gives you the opportunity as we walk along our faith We try to grow in spiritual holiness, and this organization provides a wonderful tool to do that.
We're all works in progress,
absolutely,
right?
Absolutely, absolutely. And as we're on the journey, all the more reason to join us. I mean, that's a perfect reason to join us, so that we can help support you and to help educate you in the faith.
Because the very best thing we can do for ourselves, right, is put ourselves in an environment.
Correct.
Where we can grow, where we can progress, where you can grow in your medical field knowledge, but also the ethical element and your own spirituality.
Correct.
Is right.
Absolutely.
Well, let's talk about what you're doing too for the future, you know, as far as being a leader in Catholic healthcare in the future. Are there different steps that you're taking for the future?
Correct. Well, we have our student and resident sections. I mean, they're the great hope for us for the future.
Right.
So we have a section for them. We also offer them an annual boot camp, which is a 4-day immersion in prayer, spiritual development, education on medical ethics.
Well, let's take a look at that video that you prepared now, where you get a little taste of what the medical student boot camp is about. So let's take a look at that now.
The Catholic Medical Association is building a new generation of physicians, formed in our Catholic faith, dedicated to the authentic profession of medicine, and able to apply the best of both to bring healing of body, mind, and spirit to patients. The Medical Student Boot Camp is a key part of fulfilling this goal. So, what is the Medical Student Boot Camp? First and foremost, it's built on a foundation of prayer.
We start off every morning with prayer, morning prayer, and then we have Mass and a brief time to have breakfast and talk to one another. And then we go straight into talking about our faith, our gift as a faith, what it means to be part of the Catholic faith, what it means to be a physician.
It's authentic Catholic formation.
So what is the call of the Church? We've talked about the call of Christ. What is the call of the Church? What is the call of the Church for Catholic physicians?
It seems like a retreat, but this is how, as human beings, we're meant to learn and we're meant to interact and we're meant to think about our profession in terms of being people of prayer and integrating prayer with worship, with learning, with the pursuit of truth.
I've learned an incredible amount of information the past 3 days. Not just about, like, you know, technical application of different moral issues or medical ethics issues, but also about my own spiritual journey and how that's really important to develop my own faith in order to be able to apply it actively, really to see the patient as, you know, a whole person.
It's mentoring among faculty and peers.
The physicians here are amazing. They come from all different walks of life. They talk about a whole range of topics, and they seem to be the masters of their subject.
It's been a blessing. I've never had time to sit and think through these things, and it's wonderful to ride the coattails of people who've gone through these problems and who've sat and thought and who have like-minded values.
It was exactly what I needed to meet so many people who are also striving for the same thing, and actually it was really reassuring to know that there's this huge support network that I can always turn to if I have a question.
It's been an amazing experience, really inspiring. Most of all, I think being surrounded by fellow Catholic medical students who share a lot of common beliefs and are open to discussing these sort of hot button issues.
And finally, it's fellowship. We have a goal, to make the boot camp bigger and better and improve CMA's outreach to students. Students from across the country and scores of medical schools have participated in the boot camp. Please support CMA's Medical Student Boot Camp to help medical students learn how to survive, organize, and evangelize. and to help us build the next generation of Catholic physicians.
That video gives me hope, a lot of hope.
Yeah, right?
So Mario, tell us about some of the young people that you've met that are medical students that are part of your organization.
Sure, it's one of the great programs that we have at the CMA, and just the different stories of the medical students and residents that attend it are inspiring. I'm thinking in particular, there's one resident didn't realize that she actually had conscience protection rights as a student. And so she had felt that she had to participate in different things during her rotation.
Wow.
And then she was able to go back to her residency program later and say that she didn't want to participate in these things and was able to get out of those without any repercussions. Still learning the knowledge that needed to be learned, but not
right.
having to participate in it. So that's one of the ways it's making a difference. There's another medical student. He was recently married before going to the boot camp. And they were practicing contraception. He hadn't heard the church's teaching on this before going to the boot camp.
Mm-hmm.
And he called his wife at the boot camp and said, listen, we're doing things wrong. We need to rethink this.
Wow.
And his wife was on board. And
sure.
they recently had a child. And then one last story I'll share. I could go on with many stories. But but one of the newest members of the CMA is two of the medical students had met at a boot camp and were married, and they just... Doctors Paul and Amber Day, they just recently had a child.
Sure.
But they had met through the CMA at the boot camp.
You know, and that's what our Catholic faith does. It brings something beautiful into your
mm-hmm.
life,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yes.
And so where they were practicing contraception, now they have this beautiful child, which they would never want to send back, right?
Right.
Because once you have this this gift of a child, it's like you really treasure that gift of a child.
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
Talk about clergy and religious. Are you doing things also to support them?
Absolutely.
We have a great program for clergy and religious and also physicians. It's called the Holy Alliance Program.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a partnership program between physicians and clergy, trying to match up
mm-hmm.
an actual physician with a clergy member and likewise. But physicians often are facing medical, ethical dilemmas, and they're not sure how to respond from the church's perspective.
Mm-hmm.
And so they've been partnered with a priest or religious that can help guide them through those tough choices.
Mm.
And likewise, we've heard from our clergy members that they'd love to teach on contraception, or they, in counseling
right.
couples, they want to talk about that, but they don't feel that they have adequate knowledge to talk confidently on these things. And so we provide the science to the clergy and religious to help them articulate it clearly what the church's teaching is and the science behind that. So it's a great partnership program.
You actually have on your website recommended physicians that are part of your organization as well, so.
Correct, there's a physician search feature on the top
mm-hmm.
right that anyone can go to and find an authentically Catholic practicing physician there.
Well, we know a big topic the last several years is healthcare reform.
Yes.
Talk about that, let's talk about that issue.
Well, I think most of us agree that we do need healthcare reform.
Mm-hmm.
We know that an attempt was made to address that through Obamacare,
mm-hmm.
but obviously that's a flawed program because it can conceivably force those of us who have strong moral convictions to violate our own consciences.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, just recently at the convocation of Catholic leaders, our own Episcopal advisor, Bishop Conley, outlined 4 points that should be maintained to achieve authentic healthcare reform.
Mm-hmm.
And they are, first and foremost, we have to respect the dignity and sanctity of every human life. So any
yes.
healthcare reform must respect that. Everyone should have access to healthcare,
mm-hmm.
including immigrants.
Yes.
Any healthcare reform must offer explicit and ironclad protections or conscience protections
mm-hmm.
for physicians and Catholic health institutions so they're not forced to
right.
violate their moral convictions. And any healthcare reform must be economically realistic and financially sustainable. So to me, those are 4 easy points.
Yes.
And if our president would just call our bishop, I think we can make this happen.
Those are excellent points.
Yes.
Wow. Are there ways that you're trying to present that to Congress or in some way influence Congress? Is a bishop in some way perhaps involved?
Well, I mean, when there are legislative opportunities, our physicians are getting out there to testify and to try to educate the public on these points.
Mm-hmm. We're working with legislators on Capitol Hill. I go down there regularly for meetings. We also have a robust healthcare policy committee under Dr. Steve White's leadership, and he's organizing physicians on the state level to meet with their legislators and build awareness and education about the legislation
about these
at that
issues.
Level.
Yes.
Well, it is an important issue because you know why it all came up is because some people don't have adequate health care.
That's correct.
So how do we meet that real need in a way that's economically feasible, but also respecting the dignity of every human person? I think those four points really lay that out clearly.
They really do.
At the top of the list has to be
respect.
Every life is respected,
that's
right?
That's correct. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Absolutely. So, yes.
Well, we were talking a little bit about one of your books that we have here, the Medical Saints, Blessed and Notables that we have. And the very first one that you have here is Jesus, the Divine Physician.
Yes. Yes, he is our model.
He's your model.
He is who we try to imitate in the practice of medicine.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Now, how is he a model to you? Of course, he's our Lord. He's our Savior. But also, we see that he and his own life brought healing to people in a variety of ways.
That's correct.
The soul and
that's
the body,
right? That's right. Absolutely. Throughout the Gospels,
mm-hmm.
Particularly St. Luke's Gospel, he was constantly healing wherever he went. And so that's our model. That's who we try to imitate as physicians and healthcare professionals.
So St. Luke was a physician, as the scriptures tell us, and we
correct.
Find in his gospel, which has been called a gospel of mercy.
Correct.
Because we often find these situations where people like the woman with the hemorrhage or, you know, persons in difficult situations that the Lord brought healing to them.
Sure.
And we can think, too, that I often think of the paralytic
mm-hmm.
who was brought to him by his four friends. The first thing the Lord does is heal his soul.
Yes.
My child, your sins are forgiven.
Sure.
And then
he heals
the body. And that has to be an element, too, in your own thinking, that you're not just doctors fixing a machine, like we said before.
Right.
But that you have a concern for the soul
Absolutely.
Of your people.
Absolutely.
Right? How would you have a concern for their souls? Or how would you try to help them on their deep spiritual needs?
Well, oftentimes patients who are coming to me, they have been wounded again by things like abortions or taking oral contraceptives. And so I try to reach out to them and try to get them to understand that our Lord loves us. He knows mm-hmm. that we're flawed. He knows that we're sinners, and he knows that we need healing. And
right.
so I'll try to encourage them to pray. If they're not Catholic, I encourage them to meet with their ministers.
Mm-hmm.
For spiritual support.
Right.
So that's part of the healing process. It's not simply writing a prescription or
right.
referring to another subspecialist, but your soul has to be healed as well.
Are you able to freely do that? Are you you're not in a Catholic institution, or are you?
I'm not. I'm in a mm-hmm. private setting,
mm-hmm.
but I can do that. And
yes.
I know when I can do that as well. I can't always do that.
Right.
But that is part of what we do as Catholic right. physicians and healthcare professionals.
Beautiful,
yes.
beautiful. You're a beautiful witness to bringing your Catholic faith to bear on living out your role as a physician.
Sure, I try.
Mario, if people want to learn more or people are interested in joining, being part of the Catholic Medical Association, how can they do that?
We make it very easy. Mm-hmm. They can go to the website, www.cathmed.org. That's CATHMED.ORG. And
mm-hmm.
there's a form there to sign up and get them on board. And anyone can be a member, physicians, obviously, and healthcare professionals. But clergy, religious, medical students, philosophers, theologians are all primary people that would be interested.
And any closing comments or reasons why you'd encourage people to become members?
I think to inspiring the imitation of Jesus Christ in living out your vocation. The universal call to holiness is meant for everyone, so
mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Encourage people to grow in it and
Absolutely.
See the beauty of it.
Absolutely. And for many of us, We consider this profession to be our vocation as well. Mm-hmm. So it's all the more important to join the organization for that support in our vocation.
To be a healer.
Mm, yes.
To receive healing from the Lord.
Right.
But then St. Paul says that we console others with the consolation that we ourselves have received.
That's exactly
right. So that's your mission. Well, thank you both for being on the show today.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
If you are a Catholic physician, healthcare professional, or medical student who wants to progress in living out your Catholic faith in your medical profession vocation, and to have the support and guidance that you need in the culture wars that we face today, the Catholic Medical Association may be just what you are looking for. May God bless and guide you. We will see you again this time next week for another episode of the Church Universal.